So what is the performance guarantee of this algorithm? So before we write this bound, we already discussed that the pseudo regret can be decomposed, right? We had a decomposition result. We said that the pseudo regret can be written as summation of expected number of plays of arm times the suboptimality gap. That is, we said that this can be written as so then in this case it is enough to give a bound the expected number of pulls of each of this arm, right? So in this theorem we are exactly going to do that. Most times and then pseudo regret. So if you just plug in this value in this, what you are going to get? So another thing is, we know that if some arm I is optimal, right, for that arm I del I is going to be 0 by definition, okay. So among all these del I's, there will be one del I for which this del I value will be 0. So I will just, because of that, I do not need to consider that, I am only going to consider all this I's for which del I is going to be positive and then write it. Okay, so because of this, now I am going to plug this value in this. So this is going to be all I. Plus. Okay. So we are going to get, this is upper bounded by, this is some constant 6, this is a constant, summation over all arm I where which suboptimality gap is positive, 6 log n by di del I plus summation over I, this is a constant here, right? So I can write this well as well. Okay, we are just. Oh, sorry, I don't need to. So there is a del I value in there. and we define this del I as max over mu I, maybe like mu j for all j and as mu I. Right. And now, and our convention was already we said that arm 1 is optimal, right? We said that let us assume arm 1 is optimal. That algorithm does not know, but let us assume arm 1 is optimal. Because of that, this del 1 is going to be 0, there will be some value of del 2, del 3 like that. So, del 2 will be positive, del 3 will be also positive. What I am going to now define another term as delta to the minimum value of all this delta i's where delta I is positive. Or maybe in our case, I am just going to take it as delta 2 delta I where I is greater than 1. So, what I am doing? I know because my arm 1 is optimal, delta 1 is 0, delta 2, delta 3 they are all positive. I am interested in among the positive values, what is the smallest one? Okay. So, what is this? I am saying, suppose let us say my mean is, okay, this is my highest mean mu 1, let us say somewhere mu 2 is here, mu 3 is here, mu 4 is here. Okay, let us say this is one example. I call this gap as delta 1. From here to here as delta 2. And here to here as delta 3. This one I called it as delta 2, right? And I call this as delta 3, and from here to here I call it as delta 4. Okay. What now I am saying is among this delta 2, delta 3, delta 4, take the smallest one, and that I am going to denote as a delta. Okay. So, this is for my convention, I have written this as mu 1 here, mu 2 here, mu 3, mu 4. It could be anywhere, like this could be, I could have been mu 2 and this could have been mu 3. This is just like labeling, right, whatever. What we are, what is this delta is telling is the gap between the highest mean value and the next highest mean value. So, this is the highest value here, right? What is the next highest value? In this case, mu 2. The gap between them is what? Delta is denoting. Okay. So this delta is, so by definition this delta is smaller than delta I for all I greater than 1, right? This is by definition. So it is basically saying that what is the gap between the highest mean and the next highest mean, right? This delta is exactly capturing that. So, now I will just plug in this here. So, I am going to replace this delta I by this deltas, and since this delta is a lower bound on this delta I, if I plug in, I am going to get an upper bound here. Okay. Now, if you look into this bound, is this a sublinear bound? So, how does this regret grow in n? It grows logarithmically n, right? Because of that, it is sublinear. But if you look into the order wise quantity, what is the order wise regret? It is like order wise k log n by delta, right. So, this is k minus 1, but this is constant, right. I will just take it as k, this log n, this whole divided by. So, this this should be. So, the expected regret of my UCB algorithm scales like k log n divided by delta, okay. And here this delta depends on the problem instance, right. So, the problem, if I have been given the problem instance which has mu, mu 1, mu 2, mu 3, mu 4, this delta is basically capturing the gap between the best mean and the next best mean. So, I am basically representing this complexity in terms of delta, but not all these delta i's, because delta actually matters more. Suppose now assume that you have been given mu 1, mu 2, these are the things, and your goal is to identify this mu 1. As long as there is a good separation between mu 1 and mu 2, maybe this is slightly easier. But if this mu 1 and mu 2 are very close to each other, it slightly becomes complicated, right. I am saying that if instead of mu 2 was, instead of this much separation, my mu 2 was here, it is not very far from the optimal one, okay. So, the gap between mu 1 and mu 2 is very small. Will my problem becomes easier or harder? Suppose let us say only take the case of two arms, okay. Okay, let us take in one case, I will give an instance where mu 1 happens to be 0.5 and mu 2 happens to be 0.8. I ask you to identify an arm which has the highest mean in this case. Let us say you did something and identified. And now, what I do is I will keep the first one same, but make this 0.6. So, now the gap between them has reduced, right. Will you think it will be easier here to identify which one is the best, or it will be easier to identify which is best here. Why? Because they are well separated, right. Like if let us say in a class there is only one good guy and others are all bad guys, it is easier to identify good guy, right. Like, and I mean if you want to assign only one top grade and there is only one good guy and others are all bad guy, so you know whom to assign this thing. And if there are too many good guys, maybe that is the case we have, and we want to identify whom to assign the top grade, then only one top grade, then it becomes a bit challenging, right. So, the problem is all about identifying the best from the rest, okay. So, if there are too many, I mean there are too many people who are close to the best, then it is separating the best guy from the rest slightly challenging, right. So, the problem becomes hard. So, that is why this gap matters. What is the gap between the best and the second best, the mean values of the arms, okay. Okay. So, So fine, now the question is how to show this, okay. So for that we will introduce some notation maybe, and next time we will continue it. I just said it for k equals to 2, but you can imagine, right, this should hold for any number of arms. If there are too many guys who are close to the best guy, then separating them becomes bit not so easy task. So because, and this bound is exactly capturing that. If the gap becomes very small, your bound is also going to be large accordingly, okay. In the algorithm, I wrote mu I hat of t, right. What does that meant? This is the estimate I have for arm I at time t. And what was that? Like we said, that this is nothing but the sample average of all the samples I have gotten for arm I till that point. So this is actually t I of t minus 1 summation s equals to 1 to t I, because I am going to, till when I am trying to estimate the value at time t, I am going to use these many samples, right, ti t minus 1, because till round t I have observed my arm I this many times, right. And what is this? This is going to be x times I. So the how we are going to interpret, we are going to have the average of ti of t minus 1 samples to get this mean value. But then what is this? The way we are going to interpret it is, in the, these are the, so we have arms, right, like let us say arm 1, arm 2, arm 3, like let us say arm 4 we have. Let this is, let us say this is x 1 1, this is x 2 1, x 3 1 and x 3 1. So this is in round t 1 and this is round t 2, this is going to be 2 1, x 2 2, x 3 2, x 3 2, and let us say t equals to 3. 3 1, x 3 2, x 3 3, this is k. Okay, like this you can continue, like I am going to now write some for arbitrary t. This is going to be t 1, x t 2, x t 3, x t k. So like this, so in, had you played arm 1 all the time, in round 1 let us say the sample value you observed is this, in round 2 sample value observed is this, in round 3 sample value observed is this, and in round t sample observed like 2. Had you played t all the arm number 2, this is the sample value observed. But you are choosing, right, let us suppose, let us say in round 1 you played this, round 2 you played this, round 3 you played this, so you have got this sample. And similarly, depending on which arm you played, let us say you played arm 3 in round t, you got these samples, okay. So it is not that you are getting samples from each arm in every round, right. You are going to, if you happen to play that arm in a particular round, then only you are getting samples from that. So when I write this, it may happen that for s equals to 2, s to I may not have played I term in the second round, that sample is not there. But what is our interpretation of this is, whichever slot you played, I don't care. But suppose, let's say you have this many samples, you are just take them and average. So because of that, this the way we have to interpret this. The first observed samples. Is that fine? Or you lost? All I'm saying is, so let's say I want to let's only take 2 arm case, and you happen to play arm 2 in the second and third round, and you happen to play let's take this to be t equals to 4, and you happen to play arm 1 in the first round and in the fourth round. So after this, for arm 1 you have 2 samples, and arm 2 also you have 2 samples. So now you have to, you can only average for arm 1 only these 2 samples, right? So we are saying that you are going to take this sample and this sample and average it. Okay, even though we have written that S is running from 1 to T, it is not that this sample and this sample. It is this sample and the one which you have observed till that time. Okay, and similarly here, it is going to be the average of these 2 samples here, whichever you have observed till that time. Now, so that is the meaning of the estimate mu I t here, like you are just taking average of whatever the number of samples you have observed for that. And the number of samples you have observed for arm, we are ti t minus 1 is what we have denoted as. Okay, fine. Now, how to go about the proof? Okay, we will just write it and maybe we will continue discussion. Suppose, assume that in round t, some arm I is played, and assume that this is not 1, that is, this is not the optimal one, some suboptimal arm is played. What could be the reason that suboptimal arm could have played, have been played? Yeah, according, obviously, it is played because the mu I hat t minus 1 plus, what is the confidence term we had here? 2 log t divided by t I t minus 1. This happens to be larger than rest everybody. That is why you are able to, you played it. This is happens for all j. Why this should happen? Yes, because this has happened. You played arm I in the ith round. That is what the algorithm said, right? Then why this should happen? Why, in what cases this could have happened? This could have happened because, or let us say, and this is the case, and in particular this should be also the case, that this guy is the larger than the optimal arm. So that is mu I t minus 1 plus 2 log t t I t minus 1 should be greater or equals to mu 1, the first arm. So you happen to play arm I because it is better than everybody else. So by the way, we are going to call this to be the index of arm I, okay? And in the, so earlier we defined UCB t minus 1 to be so we are going to call this index of arm I. So it is called UCB index in this case, but in general whatever the value we are going to assign to that particular arm in that round, that is going to call the index of that arm. So what UCB algorithm is doing is basically it is finding an arm which has the highest index and it is playing that, right. So because of this, what, of course the UCB index of if IT happens to be I, its index should be larger than everybody else, and in particular its index should be larger than that of the optimal arm itself in that round. That is why, and assume that this I is suboptimal. Suppose in some particular round, let us say you did not play optimal arm and you happen to play an arm I which is a suboptimal one. Now it must be the case that its index is also going to be larger than that of the optimal arm in that round, right. So this can happen. It so happened that in that round the mu I's index is kind of overestimated, right, and the index of optimal arm is kind of underestimated, or it may happen that the exploitation term dominated for the I term because of this happened because the I term was not played sufficiently many times. Okay, so okay, just to we will write it formally next time. So what could have happened? So suppose let's say this is I term and let's say this is the one with the optimal arm. So their estimates are like this. It has so happened that the true value of mu 1 is somewhere outside, it is not in the confidence term, or because of this, and what is this? Okay, so I have to make this and this confidence term is going to be this one is this, and I want it to be like this. And whatever this new one star I have, and star the confidence term is lower. New I minus is confidence. Somewhere had this happened. Okay. So obviously if I had picked I arm in round T, right, it must be the case that its upper confidence term here, which is this value, should have been larger than this point, right. That is the only reason, I mean if I have picked I term, it must be happened that this should be larger than this quantity. This is the upper confidence term for the ith one. Now because of this, in this, if this has happened further, some other cases can arise, right. It may happen that the true value of the mean, this is my interval where I am expecting my mean to lie. It may happen that it may not have lied in this, but it would have lied something outside this, and also the mean value of I which I expected it to be in this interval, that it did not lie in this interval, but it lied somewhat below. even though this mu I, we are saying that this is the optimal arm, so its value is going to be higher than this value, but it so happened that when I estimated this to be in this interval, so it is not capturing it correctly. And when I wanted to estimate mu 1, I wanted interval to somewhere here, but it has so happened that it is, this value has come below. So because of that, it is so happening that this guy is exceeding this guy, and I may end up playing I thumb. Okay, so I am just giving you pictorially what could be the possible reason I thumb has picked instead of first thumb. Okay, so fine, we will formalize in the next class and write it as 3 possible conditions.